the facelift.
A very simple term that encompasses such a broad range of technical options, it's insane.
Strictly talking about post-operative pain after facelift surgery.
When someone looks in the mirror, is to say, I look just like me.
And most importantly, and most special, is my own invention, the guanche lift.
Results that last 15, sometimes 20 years.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome your hosts of Skinterviews, the expert series, George Scandalis and Nathan Strom.
Hello, hello, hello! Welcome to another episode of Skinterviews, the expert series. Thank you. So I'm never going to get used to the live audience in here.
It's amazing.
Thank you very much for being here today. Thank you for being a part of Skinterviews, the expert series. Of course, I'm one of your two hosts. My name is George Scandalis. Wait, let them do the applause.
And my name is Nathan Strong.
You are looking bomb today, buddy. Bomb.
You know what? I've got a pretty good stylist here.
Oh, well, I'll take it.
But I must say, that suit on you.
Thank you.
You need to wear it more often.
Well, I was thinking of wearing it every single day to work, but I've been home. Working a lot from home, so you know, it's my dog thinks I'm weird if I wear a suit to work off the couch. But anyhow, today we are talking all about one of the most popular treatments in our industry, and it is the facelift. It has been wildly popular for so many years, but the last few years, ironically, we've seen a plateauing effect in the number of facelifts being performed. Why do you think that is?
Non-surgical options, George?
Absolutely. And if you remember from episode 4, which was about preventative aging, a little bit often really does go a long way. So maybe we're seeing less facelifts performed because more people are taking advantage of preventative aging through non-surgical options. What are some of those options? We've got dermal fillers.
Skincare.
Next one.
Your therapy.
All therapy. We got injectables like Botox or Dysport or Xeomin. Or Nuceiva, or Jeuveau, we gotta say them every time so nobody gets offended. If we call them neuromodulators, you may not understand exactly what we're talking about. But all these options have risen to the fact that we see less and less people getting a facelift. But the question remains, can anything ever really replace what a facelift can do for you? And we're gonna find out today from our team of experts. What I want you to do though today is I really want you to also look at their social media handles. So when you see Dr. Anna Guanche underneath her social media handle, I want you to go out there and follow her. I want you to really follow our investors, our sponsors, our producers, everybody that really makes shows like this possible, because this is how we deliver the information to you. And the more you watch, the more content we can create and the better suits I can buy. And the better styling Nathan gets. All right?
And I need all the help that I can get.
Right now, though, what we need is possibly a facelift. So let's learn about how we lift the face surgically versus non-surgically and what the experts recommend for you watching today. Can we go higher? What do you think?
I think Dr. Hammer's got a lot of work to do there.
You think so?
Yeah.
What if I get Hammer to do half face and Howley to do the other half?
You might need a bit more than that.
All right, I'm going to go call his office right now. Let's see what they have to say. Thank you for watching, everyone. Don't walk away.
So facelift, a very simple term that encompasses such a broad range of technical options, it's insane.
So what are we trying to achieve? Let's take a step back and talk about facial aging. What happens? We know that as we age, our bones start to resorb, we start to lose volume. This results in a lack of structural support and the foundation gets disrupted. Well, we also know that the facial fat compartments, they start to deflate over time, leading to that hollowed out look. You know, we also know that the skin starts to deteriorate over time. We lose the collagen, the elastin, the hyaluronic acid, and it starts to sag. It's truly a sad state of affairs.
Surgical facelifts, which vary a lot based on what layer of the face you're lifting, anywhere from the skin, fat, muscle, and sometimes even augmenting bone to lift the facial tissues.
Back in the 90s, people used to do a skin-only facelift. Looks good because you're just lifting the skin, but guess what? It doesn't have the longevity. After 6 months to a year, things start to sag again. And nowadays, we're focused on the superficial muscular aponeurotic system of the face, the SMAS. That's where the real value of the power of the lift is. And we have multiple different techniques. We have a SMAS plication where we just suture it up. We have a SMAS lift where we elevate it and lift it backwards. And that's what's going to give you that longevity of your facelift to really carry you through the years.
There is anywhere from the standard facelift, which is just stitching back the muscles and the skin, to doing a deep plane facelift, which is my favorite, which is actually repositioning the deeper layers of the face, which is the muscles, and you reposition them to their original position, and that gives you results that last 15, sometimes 20 years. So to me, that is the ultimate. And it all depends on how much downtime the patient can afford, financially, how much they can afford, and whether that's even something they're looking for. Not everybody wants to look 15, 20 years younger, right?
The goal in a facelift, the end goal, no matter how you get there, is to take what we had in our more youthful days, like that little baby, when he used to go, coochie, coochie, coo, the little big round rosy cheeks, that V-shaped face, that beautiful non-wrinkled skin, and lift everything up.
I think the best advice I can give you for this episode is to buy my book. It's called Forget the Facelift, and you can find it at Amazon. And oh, while you're there, also get my new book called Beyond Beautiful. It really shows you the value of appearance and takes you to the next level.
Many patients come in talking about someone from Hollywood, you know, Jennifer Aniston, Julia Roberts, whoever they feel looks great for their age, but they don't look like they've had work done. And, you know, they come in, they may be bothered by how their jowls or lines are causing them to maybe look sad, tired, aged, for example, and they want to do something, but maybe it's not cosmetic surgery. And so with that, we're often looking at the non-surgical facelift options. But of course, there's not, one size fits all solution, but there are things we can do non-surgically to help.
For those of you who bought the book, though, let's talk about lifting the face non-surgically. It's one of the most exciting things that we can do in aesthetics.
There are so many non-surgical options for lifting the face.
There is anywhere from neuromodulators.
There's radiofrequency, ultrasound-based skin tightening. Those can help stimulate collagen.
I was one of the first to get all therapy in my clinic, which is ultrasound skin tightening.
That actually is indicated for lift. So the studies have shown that it does lift the skin. And also because it treats down to basically the level of the fascia.
So all therapy tightens the SMAS, or the superficial muscle, which is what they lift in a facelift. And it works great. The problem is it's not always a slam dunk for everybody. And we don't understand why some people do better than others.
Laser-based treatments, so broadband light would be a very, very mild form of that.
We offer radiofrequency microneedling, which is tiny needles that have an arc of energy flowing between them that helps to contract collagen and induce a healing response.
And then we have more aggressive treatment options like CO2 lasers.
I think threads are really exciting. They were just approved in Canada. So that's, you know, it's basically like sewing. You go down and up and you yank up the, it's amazing. I think there's going to be a learning curve for that.
You can think of it as a very stiff kind of a filler that can give you either some stiffness where you need support, or some lifting where a filler may not be able to do that as well.
I do thread lifts and I have been doing them for a long time. I started out with the contour ones that are permanent threads. And then I went to Silhouette Insta, which is little cones in the threads. And now I do barbed threads. And I also do monofilaments.
Yeah, there's a few different types of threads. So there's poly L lactic acid threads. They were recently approved. There's other thread lifts made of polydioxinone, so PDO threads. And they're popular, I think certainly more popular in the US. They've been around a bit longer, and they haven't had as much traction in Canada yet. But I think on social media, you know, at conferences, there are a lot of discussion around threads.
I find that it is a niche type of a product. It's not a go-to product that I use. It's for special, specific patients under certain circumstances.
I find that there is a nice lift initially, but what happens is it loosens faster than we initially thought it would. So a lot of times people are saying it lasts 12 to 18 months. The benefits of the thread lift is that it does stimulate collagen production because those sutures are absorbable and they're replaced by collagen. And so over time, the skin overlying the treated area does look nicer. But I find that people don't love the downtime. At least here in Calabasas, it is daunting to have the bruising and the tethering and dimpling of the skin.
But one of the more effective ways to lift the face as well, without going under the knife, is actually with filler.
You could have a facelift, which lifts the face or the tissues of the face, repositions them rather, and then you might need to add volume because whether anatomically or due to the aging process, you have lack of volume. And that volume you can either add through fat or fillers. It's whatever works best in your hands or is the patient's preference.
In my hands, non-surgical facelift, the only thing I've seen reproducible and long-lasting results is to use a filler of some type.
So Sculptra, for example, and Radiesse would be two common examples of polylactic acid and calcium hydroxyapatite. So they're used in different areas of the body, different skin qualities, different age groups, and for different reasons.
Some are stiffer, some are softer, some are more stretchable, some are more flexible. So all of these different properties of the products give me ways of helping to rejuvenate my patients where I can almost in some cases compete with a facelift.
We have learned so much about youth being revolumizing the face.
Fillers are very good at doing that, restoring the volume, but also there's various techniques where we can almost lift the face and that, you know, the injectors are commonly lifting up your tissue, injecting your filler or product, and that's kind of holding these tissues up.
Volumizing and lifting can be the same thing. For example, when we revolumize the cheeks, it does redrape the skin and give a lifted appearance. When we revolumize the zygoma, we're basically adding volume, and again, the skin has to lift up to cover the new volume. And what happens is this area looks more defined and lifted. So depending on where you place the volume, you can either lift or weigh down the face. And that's the art of fillers.
It's not intuitive to lift the face. So it's not simply a matter of adding more volume to the cheeks and getting a lift. It just doesn't work that way. It's really important to understand individual anatomy, left and right side of the face, as two separate entities. One of my colleagues put it really well. He said the two sides of the face are siblings, not twins. And one side is often stronger and more mobile and will age differently than the other side. And sometimes we've had more sun exposure on one side or we sleep on one side. And all of these things will affect how your face ages differently on one side versus the other.
And they're often combined. So together, I do think filler can produce lift quite dramatically, actually. It just depends on, again, what the patient's presenting with, how much laxity, where is the laxity, how much volume do they need. But I still think that you can produce a lift with those products. It's, I think, about whether or not you can do it naturally without, let's say, addressing the skin quality. So that's a difference, I think, that needs to be elucidated by the expert.
I find that there's like some areas that are kind of like you hit that spot and you go, oh, that was it. It just makes it so much better. Sometimes it's along the periphery of the face.
Filler behind the hairline or off face can certainly reduce the risk that you're looking done. You know, you won't have that overfilled cheek, altered facial appearance or facial shape. But properly done filler by the right injector should really look natural. But if anyone's worried, you can do this off-face filler. I know Dr. Anna Guanche will talk about it, and it's often coined the Guanche lift.
Most importantly and most special is my own invention, the Guanche lift. And that is where we put strategically placed off-face filler in the areas where facelifting scars would normally be to lift and redrape the skin. It gives you an instant facelift with no surgery, no downtime. In fact, I've done this filler on people who walk the red carpet the next day. So it just gives you a nice lifted, sculpted look without surgery.
Other areas where it can be very subtle is actually the temple. So doing filler in the temple, that area actually hollows out, can look skeletonized as we age. But when you reinflate a temple, you can provide that lift to the eye area and brow, even giving an appearance that you look more rested, might look younger, but you're not done. There was actually a study just published recently that showed that when you inject poly-L-lactic acid into the temple, you can even restore the brow closer to its natural position and lift excess eyelid skin.
It definitely depends on the circumstance. So I think there are certain patients who have such skin laxity that for you to approach it just with a filler, you would be doing the patient a disservice. So I think without discussing the skin laxity, addressing the skin elasticity, laxity, looking at sort of various elements with regards to, there are many, medical terms that we use for this, but sort of the bounce back of the skin in certain zones of the body, without checking all of these things, I think to say that you could lift purely with filler in every patient and have it look natural is inaccurate.
And I always say we're not aging in one dimension, so we can't just fix it in one dimension.
So in the old days, people didn't have neuromodulators. They didn't have fillers. They weren't that good at resurfacing without making the skin look burned. So in the old days, it was cut and paste, facelift after facelift. And there would be these hollowed out elderly faces that just had like curtain poles across them.
I'm a car junkie, so I always use cars because it's easier. I said a facelift is like this, right? You've got the deep mechanics of your face. That's the body of the car, okay? Now, your frame may be a little bent or sagged, and we're gonna work on that with a surgery. But I can take the best car frame in the world, make it superior. Then comes the covering, that red candy apple paint with the wax, okay? That's your skin. So I need to focus on you. I need to do the structural work to make it good, like the car frame, but then I need to work on your skin. Whether that's lines and righteds, discolorations, sunspots, you don't want to have an awesome muscle car with a terrible body. And I'll ask people the same question. When was the last time you drove in a big fancy city and drove by a Ferrari or a Mercedes or something else, this beautiful luxury car, and saw it all full of seagull shit and scratched? It's not.
So you can cut and paste that same sun-damaged skin, but it doesn't look great unless you do something for the actual surface of the skin.
So they go hand in hand. One doesn't replace the other. They actually complement each other.
But it's understanding the order in which to do them, the right combination for each individual patient, and how to help my patients first restore and then maintain that benefit without overdoing it.
People see that their face is lifted, and again, they go back and do more and more and more, and they start getting too much filler in the cheeks where it's visible. And they start to look like what the media calls now pillow faces.
I mean, you can take someone's lips, add a filler, and get a beautiful result in contouring the lips, volumizing the lip. At some point, though, more volume doesn't give you better aesthetics. It gives you a big lip.
Some people, when they think of filler, they often think of these big cheeks, lips, celebrities who've had too much of it. But, ultimately, with the right injector, that's not an accurate picture. Filler, I think, can be used strategically. If an experienced injector is using it, filler can offer that non-surgical facelift you're after and be very subtle. The goal is not to know that you've had filler done, but to provide a gentle, subtle, natural-looking lift.
At what point does it become too much? I don't think it's the number of vials. I think it's when you're doing it, when you've reached your max.
The most important thing is having appropriate respect for limitations, right? So we can't just go ahead and fill up all the facial volume loss and expect it's just gonna fill everything up and look perfect, right? You gotta lift some, you gotta fill some. And the problem is that if you don't know your limitations, you start just filling and filling and filling and filling because you don't do the surgical aspect, that's when you're gonna get into trouble.
There's only so much that you can put in. I'm not getting any more lift. I'm not getting any more of a better artistic profile. All I'm getting now is overdone and puffy.
There's a point in time when I will do filler and I'll say, I'm not putting any more in because you won't look anatomically correct. So that's where you might want to do the non-surgical, all therapies, or surgery to try to lift.
If I take the last 10 patients that I saw for facelifts, their one concern, they weren't worried about complications, they weren't worried about the downtime, they weren't worried about the cost. They were worried and said, I don't want to look like one of those people from California, wherever, Hollywood, whatever is in their head, where they look like they're pulled back and in this like ridiculous, I stood behind a jet for 4 days look. They don't want it. That is their biggest, biggest concern. So I tell them that my goal, if my expectations for you is to get you to a point where in a year's time, when you go to your high school reunion or whatever reunion it is, your good friend looks at you and says, my God, you look great. What did you do? Your hair, your glasses, you must be living the life of Riley. Look at you. That is the goal. Not, holy shit, did you see Marilyn? Man, she is pulled tight. That is not the look we go. But we see it. And sometimes as a plastic surgeon, people ask me, why would someone want to look like that? I can't answer the question.
The people that are getting overdone, I guarantee you, are not being done by people who protect their reputation and are board certified professionals. In most cases, what happens is that person says no, and then the patient who continues to seek these procedures will go to multiple places until they find somebody who will add more, somebody who needs the money that bad. So if they want to sell you another syringe of filler and another syringe of filler, because they make money from doing this procedure, then they will do it. And just like Michael Jackson or anyone, like the cat lady that people talk about, even though the person knows this person, the last thing they need is more filler, they will find someone to do it. And usually it's a less reputable place, like we were talking about, like at a strip mall or somewhere where it's not overseen by either a board-certified dermatologist or a board-certified plastic surgeon whose reputation is on the line. If this person goes out in public and tells people, Dr. Guanche did my face or my lips, I won't want that. So I will tell them, you know, that's too much. You have too much filler in your lips, too much in your cheeks. I think we should do something else. I will try to redirect them. I will be respectful and polite, and I understand that they want something that I'm not willing to give them. But ultimately, these people who are getting overdone, they will find someone who will be willing to do it. Non-surgical options, I would say Thermage is not too painful. Ultherapy is pretty tender. I personally find it that it's a little bit painful. Some areas will always hurt a little more than others, depending on how your nerve endings are distributed. And same with Bella FX, which is our radiofrequency microneedling procedure. It doesn't hurt that much on the neck, but it may hurt a lot more in the mid-face area. So again, it has to do with how your nerve endings are distributed. But the pain doesn't persist past the time of the procedure for those tightening procedures. The Guanche lift is not painful at all because there aren't a lot of nerve endings in the areas that are injected. So mid-face is most sensitive and the lateral face is least sensitive. So we start our injections, or we do all of the injections in the lateral area where it's not very sensitive and tender.
Strictly talking about post-operative pain after facelift surgery, it's zero, okay? If you talk about discomfort, meaning sensations or feeling of pulling or pressure, patients describe it anywhere from 2 to 4 out of 10, which means they don't take pain medicine for it, they just feel that something is pulling. My answer to them is, of course, because I pulled the tissue, so it's good that you feel pulling. That means I actually did something and it's working.
The average downtime in general for a facelift without complications and everything smooth, I tell them, look, you need 2 weeks where you're kind of laying low, okay? You're not going to have a facelift and show on a Monday and show up Wednesday afternoon to deliver the town hall address. It's not happening.
So the recovery process is in stages. It depends how active you want to be at a given time.
There's the social downtime, right? Like, can't go out, I'm a little bruised, I got some stitches. That's in the 2 week realm.
Or the stage where you can actually go back to the gym and do athletic work, which usually I tell patients to wait at least 3 weeks. In case of facelift, I don't want them to turn their heads to the side for at least 2 months, because that's how long it takes for the repositioned deeper tissues to settle and to fixate themselves to where I sutured them. So we're not relying at that point on the sutures anymore. That way the patients can turn their head without having to worry that any of the stitches pull through.
Some people, you know, you see them at 6 weeks and they're completely healed. They're fine. They're great. They look perfect. They look like they had their facelift 2 years ago.
Do you already benefit from the result? You can already benefit from the results after 4 to 6 weeks.
Other people, the more average is, you know, you're getting on the 3 month, 4 month kind of timeline before the, oh, I feel a little indentation here, or I can feel that little stitch. I mean, that's a 3 to 6 month process.
Sometimes after a year, but typically 6 months is what we all tell our patients to go by.
Before we finally get to that phase where I can say to you, here's your before, here's your after, this is your result.
And there's obviously plus minus several months.
Which again, I can't emphasize enough, the patients are okay with so long as they knew going in. I think it behooves us, and I see it, and it drives me batty when I see these things that say, facelift done by Dr. So-and-so, recover in a week, back to no. Stop it. That is a marketing, and that is actually not cool. It's not cool at all because it's not true. Okay, it's to get people in the door with this false expectation that they're going to have this surgery done and in 5 days they're miraculously healed and have defied biological medical healing. No, it's not it.
There's really little to no downtime for some of these non-surgical options, and that's, of course, a major advantage. Bruising, swelling, redness with injectables would probably be the most common. Having said all that, and I think people appreciate that there's little downtime, sometimes, you know, there's limits to what we can do non-surgically, even though you'll have less downtime, and sometimes the best bet is going to be a surgical option.
But it really comes down to what the patient's expecting. You know, you got to ask your patient, what are you looking for? Mrs. Joan comes in, what do you want? They pull their face back like this and they say, I want all this done with one syringe. And if you have anything left, put it in my chin, right? It's not going to cut it. You have to have realistic expectations for what these non-surgical endeavors can provide.
If you have high expectations, but you don't choose what needs to be done, or you don't want to do what, for example, your doctor recommends to get to that goal, then you'll be disappointed, or you're handcuffing your doctor saying, well, I want to have a surgical result, but I don't want to have surgery. Well, that's just not possible.
I really think it's a discussion with each patient as to their goals, their expectation. And, you know, sometimes patients come in and they're very clear that they wouldn't do or, you know, won't even consider surgery. And in that case, of course, you're going to talk about the non-invasive options that are the alternatives.
I absolutely will tell a patient who comes in for consultation that the guanche lift, thread lift, and even the skin tightening procedures are not the same as a facelift.
I'm not really aiming for a facelift look. And the first question I ask my patients when they come in is, would you have a facelift? And for those patients who are thinking about a facelift or who want that look of a facelift or that effect, I always refer them out to my surgical colleagues, and I'm happy for them to go consult there first, because I really only want that patient who's either had a facelift and wants to maintain it, or for the patient who can't or doesn't want a facelift. And it's a different look, it's a different approach, it's a different aesthetic.
If your face is very, very wrinkled from sun damage, and so the texture is rough and you've got a lot of brown marks and a lot of redness, facelift isn't going to get rid of that. So you do the facelift for the laxity, and then you do laser to help decrease reds and browns, and you might do resurfacing laser to help decrease or improve texture and fine lines. So they're often all used together.
I absolutely think they go hand in hand, and it's unfortunate when it's a competition situation. It would be nice to have the circumstance that, again, all patients kind of get exactly what they're looking for, with a team approach. I really do think that's the best, and I hope that is more what we lean towards in the future.
If someone's looking for a more permanent option or has significant, you know, skin laxity, heavy jowl, neck laxity, I think, you know, certainly discussing the option of surgery and reviewing that as a treatment consideration, that might be in the patient's best interest if that's something they would be willing to consider.
At the end of the day, it really depends what the problem is. If you've got a loss of volume, then yeah, Non-surgical things are gonna help. They're gonna improve the volume. You can do skin tightening, which is gonna give you some mild degree of improvement in the skin laxity. But if you've got big jowls hanging down, you've got a lot of laxity, the skin and the face and the neck, nothing is gonna do what a facelift can do.
If you don't have enough experience and try to promise the world or the patient too much, to promise some surgical results with non-surgical methods, everybody's gonna be disappointed. And worse even, people are gonna label the non-surgical methods as, well, they don't work, or it's not worth it. And it's not that they don't work, it's just they weren't used for the right indication and for the right patient's expectation.
If you're in your 40s, we can make you look really amazing. If you have a lot of saggy skin and you're in your 60s to 80s, we're gonna make you look better. Your skin's gonna be tighter, smoother, and improved and lifted, but it won't be the same as actually cutting and removing that skin and redraping it.
It's really about helping somebody look like themselves, but to restore their balance and to restore volume without making someone look overfilled or overdone. It's not always about getting rid of all the lines or wrinkles, because it's not something I believe in. You've heard me say that before, but it's really about restoring the balance and the contours.
First of all, whenever somebody comes in and says, I want Kate Moss's cheekbones, I'm like, no.
I think the biggest compliment you can get is when someone looks in the mirror is to say, I look just like me. And that's always what I wait for from my patients, is that they love how they look and they recognize themselves in the mirror.
If you look at young kids, they have apple cheeks. And one of the things, first things we lose as we get older is our fat pads, right? So that as this starts to decrease, it draws the face down. So replacing that, so replacing what you had is what we're doing oftentimes with fillers. Having realistic expectations is really important. And I take a lot of time in explaining to patients what we can and cannot do, and so that they're happy at the end.
You know, I think some of these things are trends. You know, fox eyes, the Russian lips, and so I think if a patient comes in requesting that type of trend, I think it's important to understand, you know, what they're trying to achieve. Some people want just a little bit of a brow lift. They're not looking for the same degree of fox lift that's often seen on social media. So understanding that and reviewing what they can achieve that looks natural but gives them a little bit of that. But as it relates to trends, we do know trends come and go, and there can be downsides with some of these trends. And so making sure we have an open discussion with patients as to what potential downsides there are to pursuing those treatments, recognizing that this trend may be here this year and next year it's on to something else, I think that's important to review as well.
There are times when a patient comes in and they're misunderstanding what fillers can do. And they want just a line gone, or they want something to be addressed, but in reality, trying to address that line won't actually add value to their appearance, or really won't meet their expectations. So in those cases, I have a conversation and I show them that, you know, you may see nasolabial folds or marionette lines, but it really comes from volume loss in the lateral face. So it's a project to try to lift it all the way out laterally, and just filling that line is going to make the central face too full and the lateral too flat, and that disconnect won't actually make you look better. So if you can show them why you don't think addressing exactly what they see directly is a good idea. And I tell them that sometimes when you see a line, it's a reaction to something that's happening someplace else. And so I need to address the source, not just chase the end result of it, the outcome of it. And it's really about just explaining it really clearly. And sometimes they're willing to then invest and have the fillers done where I think they need it, or have surgery that's more appropriate. But to try to just put in a syringe of filler to try to erase a line isn't always a great idea. On the other hand, if a line bothers a patient, you can address everything else, but if you don't make that line go away, even if they look amazing, they're not gonna be happy. So I also have to be careful to address what they see, not just what I know I can fix to make them overall look better. And that's a conversation and a balance that can sometimes be very tricky.
So if we're gonna take a patient who's here for a facelift, she may not leave with a facelift. She may never have a facelift, and we don't care. What we care about is that we've achieved something for her, that her expectations were met, and she is happy. And quite commonly, if I look at what the common denominator is, It's commonly using some type of modality, whether it's laser, skincare products to help with discoloration and the quality of the skin, plus or minus filler injections and Botox. And then we get into the deeper plane, the frame of the car. Then we get into the facelift.
When I do have consultations with patients and they're unfortunately, you know, maybe not a non-surgical candidate, and they ask me about, you know, surgeons that I think they should see, short of giving names, I think the one thing that I would, you know, tell them is that I would, without question, even if someone, let's say, is recommended to you, I would meet more than one surgeon who is, you know, going to consider doing the treatment that you're looking for. And even for myself, even if it's non-surgical, I encourage people, if they're, you know, unsure about our consultation or want more information, or it's a really big decision for them, to seek out another opinion.
I find with noses and faces, sometimes each surgeon has a slightly different take on what they feel is beauty. And so you want to make sure you meld that. Take time and do research and go see a couple different people. That's my advice.
You really want to be in the hands of someone that you completely trust, that you feel like has heard you, that you feel like understands what your goals are, what your needs are, what you're hoping for in terms of result, who has taken the time to, again, educate you about things like whether the result is permanent, whether you might need maintenance, what the risks are.
Just like any surgery, things can go wrong in a facelift too. The most common things are usually aesthetic though, right? Somebody's been pulled too tight, they've got that windswept look, or a pixie ear. What's that? It's a tethered earlobe that appears like it's attached to the side of the face rather than free hanging. The hallmark of a good surgeon is how good a scar is, but more importantly, how good that earlobe looks.
Many patients, you honestly would not be able to tell that they've had surgery. So I see it, you know, on their medical history. And so we know that they've had surgery, but they certainly look very, very natural. Their scars have healed beautifully. They're tucked away. You can't see them at all. So those are, you know, excellent examples and excellent cases of great surgical results. And then, of course, we see patients who maybe have had a good result, but their scars haven't healed so well.
When you cut into the deeper layers of the skin, you're going to get a scar because the deeper layers of the skin, you only get one of them. That's the dermis. That's where your collagen and elastin is. And so once you have the scar, you have to actually disrupt the skin again by stamping it, holes into it, or lasering holes into it, or resurfacing it to try to increase new collagen growth to decrease the scar thickness or the roughness.
I do hear commonly that, you know, patients are looking for something permanent.
Doc, is this permanent?
For sure it's permanent. We're making big changes. But the thing you have to understand is that just because we turn back the clock doesn't mean we stop time. So even though we've taken off 10 years, your skin is still going to age at the normal rate.
The clock keeps ticking no matter what we do.
Whether it's surgical or non-surgical, no treatment is permanent.
I would like to say that nothing in the facelifting world is permanent. Even a facelift is not permanent. What happens is the skin and tissues change over time.
If I turn back the clock 10 years, 10 years from now, I'm going to look like I look today. That's great.
So certain treatments will be much longer lasting. A surgery should be longer lasting, let's say, than a non-surgical method, but everything requires maintenance.
I would say over 80% of my patients come back 8 months to a year after surgery, and they all do the same thing. They all go like this, and they go, I just wanted this much more. And there's something after surgery where you're swollen and your face looks fuller and everything looks really tight and they think, oh, this is so good. But, you know, it's going to relax over time. I mean, surgery is the new point of aging, and then skin relaxes. It starts to come down a little bit. And that's where I come in, because that's where my devices, my fillers, my neuromodulators can really help my patients look better and can enhance that surgical procedure and make it last longer.
As far as the guanche lift goes, it lasts 9 months to a year. If it's done with some fillers, it can last up to 2 years with longer lasting fillers. And so it needs to be added to and it needs to be maintained. And definitely my patients do come in and say they want to add to it and they want to spruce it up. They call it zhuzhing. As far as facelifts go, they do last longer, but they start to sag in about 5 to 7 years, depending on what the person's doing with their lifestyle.
And although everything underneath might be looking good and tight, you don't see it as well as you hoped for post-surgically because that skin quality is just not there.
One of the things I wish my patients knew about surgical options is that it's not a one and done. that even after surgery, they're still going to need their expert dermatologist injector to help enhance those surgical results and help maintain them as well, to give them the best outcome for the longest amount of time and hopefully make it so they never have to have another facelift in the future.
I think that is something that needs to be brought up at consultations. I do wish patients knew that nothing was permanent.
So nothing's permanent in this world.
Nothing is permanent. We're not permanent, okay? We don't last forever.
It's our job to educate patients on that. So I think this is a great forum to do so.
Yes, I would have a facelift. Just to reference, would not have a BBL. It's already great. The facelift, yes. I'll tell you why I would have a facelift. Because we talked about this before about genetics or whatever. I'm going to look like my dad. Why? Because I have a dad, like everyone. So starting to get that jowling, right? I'm losing some volume in my cheeks. So fillers, fill those cheeks, lift it up. Because lifting it up, really, it has to be subtle, right? I don't have to have the big pull. Just a simple, even if I had what people call the mini facelift, you know, a little incision in front of the ear, just tacking up, decreasing these nasolabial folds. Yes, absolutely, I'd have a facelift, for sure.
I can't actually have a facelift because I had an injury as a young woman, or I broke the side of my face. And so I have metal plates and I can't do all therapy because it's ultrasound, and I can't do a facelift because I have too much scar tissue. So it's out for me. I could do my neck, but yeah, I'm going to have to rely on diet and exercise and sleep.
If I get to a point where I look in the mirror and I feel I don't look the way I feel, meaning I look much older than I feel. What I see in a mirror doesn't represent who I am and how I feel, absolutely. You know, there's absolutely no shame in the game. You know, especially when it's done well and naturally, you know, who doesn't want to look 10, 15 years younger? You know, sign me up.
You know, as much as I hope not to need one, would I consider one? I would. You know, I certainly would if that was the case. I think that... again, I feel that I'm doing, you know, my best to prevent. I know what my genetic background is. I know that there are certainly chances that certain things will not go my way despite all of my effort. And I certainly would consider a surgical facelift if that was something that was at some point felt to be necessary from a reverse aging perspective.
I would absolutely consider getting a facelift. In fact, I went for a consultation for a facelift because I was doing more video work and I was starting to see like things that I didn't like around the jawline, and I went to see someone, and that is what eventually led me to inventing the Guanche lift, because the quote that I got, the downtime, the information about what this person thought I needed, and he is a top plastic surgeon, just made me realize I can't take 2 to 6 weeks off of work, or I don't want to. I can afford $70,000 or $80,000, but I mean, I wasn't really ready to commit that at the time. And you know, the amount of different procedures he was recommending wasn't just a facelift, but I think you need this for your eyes and this for your lips and this for your brow. And it just felt like I was going to come out a different person, completely different person. And I decided for myself that I'm not ready. Will I be ready one day? Yes. But in the meantime, I do all the other procedures and the Guanche lift, and I feel like I'm happy now. But I do tell my patients there might come a time when that stuff is not enough and you're ready to have surgery and you're willing to take the risk and the expense, then it's time to do it.
What another great episode, George.
It was an amazing episode. I'm flabbergasted because now I'm debating what I need to do to lift my face. Who do I see? What options do I pick? What, Nathan, you got to stop that while we're on camera. I told you could do that in the dressing room. You can make fun of me all you want, but we can't do it on camera. Although, here's the thing, though. I'm comfortable enough in my own skin that I would say if I've had a facelift, I would say if I've had a plastic surgery, I would actually recommend one of our experts if I go to see them. And we implore you to reach out to them on their social media, ask them the questions you want. Of course, we love getting comments. We love getting questions. We answer them all. We get to meet all our Studio Live audience after every episode. And if you want to be a part of our audience, like all the people here today, what do you got to do, Nathan?
You've got to go to skinterviews.world and follow us on Instagram, skin.tviews, and Facebook
and LinkedIn. Skinterviews by Nathan and George. I'm George. He's Nathan. We learned about facelifts. What do you think we got next? You got to tune in to find out. We'll see you all on the next episode of Skinterviews, the expert series. I didn't say week.
Thank you and good night.
Bye, everybody.